wanted to talk about subject of this. I guess I find interesting, and if I find it interesting, maybe you'll find it interesting. You may not, but it's something I find interesting, and it's. And I want to turn to begin this subject by looking in John 18. We're going to read some scriptures, and that's going to kind of set the backdrop of what we'll be looking at today. So in John 18. And in verse 33, we're going to get into the story here of what happened with between Pilate and Christ. When Pilate was, you know, when Christ was taken after he was arrested to Pilate before he was crucified, and this is the story of, you know, the what took place between them. Verse 33 of John 18 says, "Then Pilate entered the praetorium, again called Jesus and said to him, 'Are you the King of the Jews?' And Jesus answered him, 'Are you speaking for yourself about this, or did others tell you this concerning me?'" It was just, you know, going around. Pilate answered, "Am I a Jew, your own nation, and chief priests have delivered you to me? What have you done?" 36. Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would fight so that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But now my kingdom is not from here." And Pilate therefore said to him, "Are you a king then?" And Jesus answered, "You say rightly that I am a king. For this cause I was born, and for this cause I have come into the world, that I should bear witness to the truth." To the truth. "Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice." So that's kind of what I want to focus on. Everyone who's of the truth hears my voice. And Pilate said to him, "What is truth?" What is truth? And it's interesting that Pilate was asking a question 2,000 years ago that people are still asking today about what is truth. Because there's talk about fake news and alternative facts. I was talking about that before people were talking about it in things, so it kind of makes me sick hearing about it so much. But people talk about, you know, they're trying to figure out what is true. You have fact checkers and you have people looking, trying to find what is true in life and what are true facts or what are alternative facts and all this things. And it's something that, you know, and it's interesting that the world is talking about this, but this is something that we in the Church of God have been addressing for years. We've been talking about the truth for years because we believe in truth. We believe in absolute truth. And again, it's probably a lot different than what the world thinks of as truth. Before the World Wide Web, you know, there's times, you know, young people, there wasn't World Wide Web back when I was in college. When I was in college, there was no World Wide Web. And I spent a lot of time in the library. I was studying engineering. But for some reason, I just love going to the library and reading books about other things. Because, you know, the first time I had access to this really big library and all these interesting books about all these different subjects. And so, again, it's a little more difficult to access information. If I want to know something now, I can, you know, Google it on my phone. I think I've even heard stories where, like, somebody's up here giving a message and somebody will say something and somebody's out there checking to see if what they're saying is true. Because there was, and I'll relate this story, there was one of our, and again, I've talked to him about it so I can say this, but there was a person, he was giving a story about how like a certain animal uses like suction cups on the bottom of their feet, like a chameleon or something to stick to glass. And somebody was like looking that up and they said, "Well, it really wasn't suction cups, it's like little hairs or something." And so they addressed them later, said, "Well, you know, it really isn't suction cups, it's really these little hairs and some kind of other process." And it's like, you know, that's how much we can find information about something so easily. But back then, it wasn't that way. You had to go to the library, and you had to look, and you had to read books. And there's a lot of books. And the thing that I found out when I was looking at different books, and mostly I was interested in finding books about the Bible, about God's Word. That's really kind of where, you know, I would study other things, but I really would get into reading things about God's Word. I was trying to figure out what really was true in God's Word. So I was in the library, looked through the books, and when I would research a certain topic, I would often encounter two different views, and many times they were contradictory. So I'd read this one book and it'd say this is true, and I'd read this other book and say this is true, and this other person's not true. And so the thing that I kind of realized when I was doing this is like, if there's only one truth, well, one of those books had to be lying, not necessarily knowing it, but one of the books had to be false, right? For if there's an absolute truth, and if there's two different takes on something, there can only be one truth. And another thing I found out, because a lot of times in the library, you know, they don't have the latest updates of books, So sometimes you may go read an old science book, and I have some old science book I had when I was a kid, that a lot of that science in that book is not true anymore. They found out a lot more information about the science. So a lot of the books would have false information in it because, you know, we've learned more or learned something different there. So Pilate asked Jesus, what is truth? And again, it could be confusing to a lot of people. So I think there's maybe a lot of people, a lot of young people out there who go over the internet and it's so easy to find, you know, read all these contradictory things about stuff, and you get all this mismatched information. And I've had people see people on Facebook who say, I'm not even sure what I just posted was true, because they don't know. Because it's just, that's what kind of Satan wants. Satan wants this kind of, this air that we can't know what is true. And Pilate asked Jesus, what is truth? And Christ says, those who follow him love the truth. Love the truth. And I believe here that we found the truth. Don't we believe that? That we have found the truth. And we've been talking about this for years in the Church of God. Since the very beginning, you know, a couple thousand years ago. That the truth is Christ. Jesus is truth. The Word of God. And we believe things that are very different from the rest of the world, I think. You know, concerning the nature of God. You know, there's people who may be watching on this, and we'll talk about things where, like, believe it, we don't believe in the Trinity. That's one of the things that's different from us than the rest of the world. But we believe in God, and we believe in Father, and we believe in the Holy Spirit, but we have a different belief on that. And so we have a little bit different view on some things. And concerning the nature of God, the future resurrection, God's plan for mankind. And many people will say that we don't know the truth, that we're false, that we're deceived, because, you know, we just believe what it says. Because I think if you read simply the simple words, what Christ says, it's like anybody can read this. There's a really easy story to understand, a fabulous story of the gospel that God has for us. And it's really simple to understand the truth. It's not difficult. It's very easy. I'll show you some things about that. So some say that their version of Christianity is the truth. And maybe someday, some people say that their version of science is the truth, or their religion, which is different than us, is the truth. And there's 4,300 religions. That's a lot of religions. And so, think about that. If there's 4,300 religions, that means 4,299 are not right. I mean, it has to be. I mean, even if we weren't right, if there's one that was right, all other ones would have to be false. But, you know, I believe that we found the right thing. But God, in his perfect wisdom, in creating God, you know, when he created the Word and he gave us the laws, he gave us a test of truth so that we can know which of the 4,300 religions is true, which beliefs are actually true. He has built into his Word a test, so you can test truth, and it's something that's logical. You can look at the evidence and say, okay, that's true or that's not true. There can't be any arguments about it. And this is in Deuteronomy chapter 18, a test of truth. In Deuteronomy 18, verse 20, it says, but the prophet who presumes to speak a word in my name, which I have not commanded him to speak, right, somebody who speaks says, hey, I'm speaking for Yahweh, speaking for God, and, you know, God didn't send him, or who speaks in the name of other gods, all 4,299, all those other gods, that prophet shall die. And if you say in your heart, how shall we know the word which the Lord has not spoken? Like, how do we know the truth? How do I know that when somebody else, you know, wants to tell you that this Bible tells that Christ is going to return, you know, on August 15th of this year, and we need to be ready for it, and, you know, how do we know that? How do we know where God has spoken or not spoken? And maybe something not as elaborate as that, or even something more subtle. How do we know when we say that there's going to be a resurrection, and you can be a part of that resurrection, you can be in God's kingdom, as opposed to somebody who says you're just going to, you know, go to heaven or something? How do we know what's true or not? And he says, when a prophet speaks in the name of the Lord, if that thing does not happen or come to pass, that is the thing which the Lord has not spoken. That's common sense. He says, the prophet has spoken it presumptuously, and you shall not be afraid of him. A simple test. Right? This is something that we should be able to get even an atheist to agree on, or even a skeptic. And again, I admire some skeptics, because a lot of times they're really good at looking into things and trying to figure out what's true or not, but they kind of mess it up when they come to the Bible. They let their skepticism blind them to all the facts that we have in God's Word. But I would ask somebody who's a skeptic or an atheist or somebody who really believes and wants to know what is true, you know, this doesn't make sense, right? If a prophet says something's going to happen, right? So if a prophet predicts an earthquake at 3 p.m., I'm going to ask somebody who doesn't believe, if a prophet says there's going to be an earthquake at 3 p.m., and at 3 p.m. there's an earthquake, I would say, well, that might be something to think, oh, that might be a true prophet, because he predicted something and it came true exactly like it said it was. Again, and even if you say you're not a prophet, because there's people who say they're not prophets, they still make predictions, right? It's still false. You know, and again, I'm not going to be to believe you or be afraid of you. Because again, many people have made doomsday predictions. They still do. And if you look at other books, you look at like, I don't want to, you know, just go to every all the 4299. But if you look at it, like the different books that are outside the Bible, like Quran or Book of Mormon or all these other scriptures, they make predictions about things. Like the Book of Mormon, for example, predicts that Jesus would be born in Jerusalem. Well, that's wrong, right? Because God's Word, he was born in Bethlehem. So again, you can go back and you can find in all these different books where they make predictions and the predictions fail. Every other book except for God's Word makes predictions and they all fail. So but again, I don't want to focus on those books. They all that evidence is out there for that. I want to tell you, because I'm an advocate of this book, of God's Word, does this pass the test? Does God's Word pass the test that he put in there that if something, the prophet says something's going to happen and then it takes place, then it's confirmed that it comes from God? And if that's the case, we should really pay attention to what God has to say about other things, right? So let's look at that. So we'll apply this test directly to the prophets in the Bible. And really, a lot of people out there don't really know how accurate the prophets actually were. So while we're still in Deuteronomy 18, we're going to jump back a couple of verses to verse 15, because again, this is the prophecy right here in context of this. In Deuteronomy 18, verse 15, it says, "Then the Lord, your God, will raise up for you a prophet like me from your midst, from your brethren. Him you shall hear, according to all you desire the Lord, your God in Horeb in the day of the assembly, saying, let me not hear again the voice of the Lord my God, nor let me see this great fire any more, lest I die. And the Lord said to me, what they have spoken is good. I will raise up for them a prophet like you, like Moses, from among their brethren, and I will put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak to them all that I command him. And it shall be that whoever does not hear my words, which he speaks in my name, I will require it of him." So here's the prophecy. This is a big prophecy that Moses makes. There's going to be he says there's going to be a prophet after him that's going to speak the words of God. So this is a pretty specific prediction. We can look in history and say, did this take place? Was this true? Can we trust anything else Moses had to say? Well, in John 1, we can see, John 1, verse 43, we can see where there's some people say they think they may know who this applies to. In John 1, 43, it says, just a couple of verses, says, "The following day, Jesus wanted to go to Galilee, and he found Philip and said to him, 'Follow me.' Now, Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter, and Philip found Nathanael and said to him, 'We have found him of whom Moses and the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph.'" So they say, we found the person that was in this prophecy right here. We found this person. So anybody can make that claim. We can say, oh yeah, well, we found the person over here. We found the person in India. So what other evidence do we have that Jesus fulfills that prophecy about a prophet who would come who would be like Moses? Well, we go to Acts chapter 2. We have Peter who makes the case in Acts chapter 2 and verse 22. He says, "For Moses truly said to the fathers, 'The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from your brethren. Him you shall hear in all things, whatever he says to do.'" So he says, he quotes the same thing. He's saying, Jesus fulfilled this. So did he do this? Well, we can read the things that he said. We can read what Christ says. And again, maybe I'm biased because I've had hands laid on me and I have God's Spirit. But I believe what Christ says is pretty spectacular. The things that Jesus says about how to live your life and how to, you know, have a wonderful, abundant life are amazing. We can read the Sermon on the Mount. We have the, and John gives a list of all these confirmed miracles that we already have eyewitnesses and people in history that confirmed that Jesus did miracles and healed people. So we have, I would say, a prophecy fulfilled that what Moses spoke of, that somebody would follow me who would speak the words of God. We had that prophecy fulfilled in Jesus Christ. So what does that do for Moses, right? So Moses passes the test. Moses passed the test. And so, again, there were things that he did in his day, right? You know, the plagues on Egypt. So people, they could see it. Because we didn't see that. I didn't see Moses, you know, part the Red Sea. I didn't see when he stuck his hand into his cloak and his hand, you know, his hand come out, you know, with, all nasty looking and whatnot. But they did. So they had confirmation physical. They could see there that he was a prophet speaking for God. But now we have confirmation in history that he spoke about this, you know, thousands of years before this. We have it in Christ. Moses was a prophet. He spoke. We need to take what he says to be, you know, important. So what does that mean for us? And for someone who may be a skeptic, it means that Moses is a very credible source, right? The laws that he gives, when he says that God gives the Ten Commandments, I trust it. I trust it. Yeah, I mean, maybe I wasn't there, but I trust that Moses, when he says that's the Ten Commandments, those commandments came from God because Moses was a confirmed prophet. So the information we have about him that he wrote in Genesis through Deuteronomy, we have proof that Moses predicted something and fulfilled over 1,000 years later. So let's look at another prophet. We have other prophets and see if they passed the prophet's test. Let's look at Isaiah. So Isaiah was an interesting prophet. Isaiah 44 makes an interesting prediction. Isaiah 44 and verse 28. He says, "Who says of Cyrus, 'He is my shepherd, and he shall perform all my pleasure,' saying to Jerusalem, 'You shall be built, and to the temple your foundation shall be laid.'" So he's talking about this guy named Cyrus. Right, somebody named Cyrus. Go up to the next chapter, verse 1. He says, "Thus says the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus," he mentions him again, to Cyrus, "whose right hand I have held to subdue nations before him and loose the armor of kings, to open before him the double doors, so that the gates will not be shut." And then down to verse 13, he says, talking about Cyrus still, he says, "I have raised him up in righteousness, and I will direct all his ways. He shall build my city and let my exiles go free, nor for price nor reward, says the Lord of hosts." So again, this was predicted 150 years before Cyrus lived. Okay, so not only was he named, before the Jews, 80 years before the Jews were taken in captivity, saying that Cyrus was going to be the one to let them go free. All right, and Cyrus was the leader of time of Persia. Okay, so we can read of this fulfillment in 2 Chronicles 36, 22, and 23. And again, there's going to be those skeptics out there going to say, "Well, how do you know that Isaiah actually wrote this and this was written before the fact?" Well, I'm going to show you how we know that we know he wrote this before the fact. But first, we're going to look here a confirmation in 2 Chronicles. All right, so the proclamation of Cyrus says, "Now in the first year of Cyrus, the king of Persia," what am I reading? I'm reading in 2 Chronicles chapter 36, verse 22. "First year of Cyrus, king of Persia, now the word of the Lord came by the mouth of Jeremiah might be fulfilled. The Lord stirred up the spirit of Cyrus, king of Persia, so that he made a proclamation throughout his kingdom and also put in writing, saying, 'Thus says Cyrus, king of Persia, all the kings of the earth the Lord God of heaven has given me, and he has commanded me to build him a house at Jerusalem, which is in Judah, who is among you all his people. May the Lord his God be with him, and let him go up.'" So that's a prophecy 150 years beforehand. Isaiah talks about this guy named Cyrus and what he's going to do. And there's those out there who say Isaiah must have written this after Cyrus. But also we have a historian who actually has an account of how Cyrus received this information. And this is in Josephus. Y'all have heard of Josephus. Josephus was a historian. He wrote the Antiquities of Jews and other works. And so Josephus writes about how Cyrus heard about this information. Because, you know, if somebody wrote about you 150 years before you were alive, chances are somebody's going to say, "Hey, you know what? I think something was written about you." and they would probably bring it to him. That makes perfect sense. That's exactly what happened. And we can read it. This is in Antiquities of the Jews, and this is in book 11 of that. If you want to, you can search it, find this book, and what I'm saying is recorded history. So I'm going to read from Josephus, and he says, in the first year of the reign of Cyrus, which was the 70th from the day that our people were removed out of their own land into Babylon, God commiserated the captivity and calamity of these poor people, according as he had foretold to them by Jeremiah the prophet before the destruction of the city, that after they had served Nebuchadnezzar and his posterity, and after they had undergone that servitude 70 years, he would restore them again to the land of their fathers, and they should build their temple and enjoy their ancient prosperity. And these things God did afford them, for he stirred up the mind of Cyrus and made him write thus throughout Asia, thus says Cyrus the king. And anyway, he goes through what we just read about the proclamation we just read. And then he says, this was known to Cyrus by his reading the book which Isaiah left behind him of his prophecies. So it is recorded in history that somebody brought to Cyrus and said, look, this guy Isaiah wrote something about you. And the prophet said this, that God had spoken thus to him in a secret vision, my will is that Cyrus, who am I appointed to be king over many and great nations, send back my people to their own land and build a temple. And so this was foretold by Isaiah 140 years before the temple was demolished. And again, I'm reading that right from Josephus. 140 years. And again, most likely, who was it? It was Daniel, who probably had access to it and showed it to him and said, look, you're written about it. You right here. This is what you're going to do, believe it or not. And so that is a prediction. Right, that's a strong prophecy that's fulfilled. One of the greatest that we can show. So the numerous prophecies of Isaiah about Christ, because I wanted to bring in Christ in every one of these, because Christ is a great fulfillment of prophecy. But in Isaiah 9, verse 6, he says, "For unto us a child is born, and to us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." Who else could fulfill that? No one else. Jesus Christ fulfilled that prophecy. Isaiah, right? He says of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. All right? Isaiah has credibility. He has credibility. That if there's something in Isaiah that's still yet to be fulfilled, because there's some things we read in Isaiah still hasn't happened. There's things that haven't happened. There are many prophecies that point to the kingdom of God being restored on earth with Jesus as the king. And because of the provable prophecies that have been fulfilled, we know Isaiah speaks on behalf of God. Right? God, we can say, all right, Moses speaks on behalf of God. Isaiah, if he says something, he says, God says this, even though it hasn't happened yet, I believe it because he passed the prophet's test. He passed the prophet's test. We also have Micah. We have other prophecies, We have Micah 5:2. Says that the Messiah will be born in Bethlehem, right? And we can clearly see God's hand in these Old Testament prophets, all right? So I could go through all of them. I could show you example after example of prophecy fulfilled. Let's go to the New Testament. Because they say, all right, well, how do you know that some of the things that are said in the New Testament have been fulfilled? Because a lot of that sounds like it hasn't happened yet. Well, no, there's things that have been predicted in the New Testament that have happened, that have physical evidence of being predicted. And one's in Matthew 24. Matthew 24, we have Christ, right? It's the reason why I can say Christ fulfills a lot of this stuff, because when Christ spoke, he made predictions, and they happened, especially the prediction about he was resurrected. That was a good one, and they all saw that, but again, we weren't there to see that, but there's something we can still have witness to today. So Matthew 24, verse 1, says, Jesus came out from the temple and was going away when his disciples came up to point out the temple buildings to him, and he said to them, do you not see all these things? Right? So he shows up the temple buildings. Truly I say to you, not one stone here will be left upon another which will not be torn down. Now, that's a prophecy about the temple. Now, if the temple was still there, we could say he was a false prophet. We could say that. If the temple was still there, he was a false prophet. But we have a test. That's a test that happened in August of A.D. 70. After Christ was gone, even after this book was written, because we know this book was written probably in the 40s or 50s, that the Romans invaded Jerusalem and they destroy the temple. And people say, well, what about the Wailing Wall? Okay, that's not the temple. The Wailing Wall is just the foundation of that big area where the temple was. Right? No stone. If you go up there right now, not one stone is left upon another of the temple. Right? There's a mosque built there in its place. And again, we may not have been there to witness Christ turning water into wine, or walking on water, feeding the multitudes, or his resurrection, but we can clearly see a prediction right now with physical evidence that this man 2,000 years ago said the temple would be destroyed, and we go look, it ain't there. That is a confirmed eyewitness physical proof, what I would call hard evidence. All right, what about others in the New Testament, right? Because Paul makes some predictions. He makes some predictions that haven't happened yet, but he makes some actually that have happened. I'm going to look at one and test these predictions. All right, and in 1 Timothy chapter 4, 1 Timothy chapter 4, Paul makes a prediction, and I believe, you know, I think there's evidence that this has been fulfilled. It may have been fulfilled in various ways, but I'm going to show you where I specifically think this could count as a fulfillment of what he says to happen. 1 Timothy chapter 4, in verse 1, says, "Now the Spirit expressly says that in latter times," and again, when he says latter times, he doesn't necessarily mean like the end times. He's saying this times after him, right? Latter times, the time since Christ has been there. "Latter times, some will depart from the faith, giving heed to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons, speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their own conscience seared with a hot iron, forbidden to marry, and commanding to abstain from foods which God created to be received with thanksgiving by those who believe and know the truth." So two things he says here, right? "For every creature of God is good, and nothing is to be refused to receive with thanksgiving, for it is sanctified," that word sanctified, for y'all, those of y'all who try to want to put in pig and catfish into this, sanctified means set apart by the word of God and prayer. So there's foods in God's word that he set apart that we know that are perfectly fine for people to eat. These are good foods, and are set apart by the word of God in prayer. So Paul says in latter times, that's something that times after his death, before the return of Christ, two predictions that people who, you know, would follow, that who came from what he was preaching, would forbid the marry, and they would command to abstain from clean foods that God created. All right, so these are two things. So, and as early as the year 305 A.D., we have a council called the Council of Elvira, and these are, you know, professing Christians. And I don't want to use the word professing Christians and try to say that, you know, they're not Christians, or we're Christians, they're not Christians, because we're professing Christians. We profess Jesus Christ. These are people who profess Jesus Christ as their Lord. But in this council, people who says, hey, we follow Christ, they said, and I'm going to read what they said, right? You know, Paul predicted this. They said, in this council, it is decided that marriage be altogether prohibited to bishops, priests and deacons, or to all clerics placed in the ministry, that they keep away from their wives and not beget children. This is something, again, you know, Paul says somebody in latter times they're going to have a doctrine that's false about not marrying. Well, here's one example. And again, we have other councils and we have other examples, you know, of different bodies of professing Christians or people who say we follow Christ, but we teach something that Paul predicted was, he calls a doctrine of demons. And what we do factually know that this practice has led to a widespread sexual immorality and abuse. And this has hurt a lot of people, this doctrine of demons, right? And this is not my opinion. I'm just saying this is what we have as confirmed facts, that this doctrine has led to a lot of problems that people can see, psychologists have seen, people can see in history. All right, I would say, I think that prophecy is fulfilled. That is a fulfillment to me of that prophecy. A second part of the prophecy, commanding to abstain from foods God set apart, that he sanctified in Scripture. God said, hey, there's certain things, you know, you can eat these things. Again, this has happened by people who profess Christ in latter times. A lot of places I can give you examples, but I'm going to read you something in the United States, because it's something I found in the United States that people there wrote. It says, in the United States, the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops has declared that the age of fasting is from the completion of the 18th year to the beginning of the 60th. And it says the council also allows substitution of some other forms of penance for abstinence on all of the Fridays of the year, except for those Fridays in Lent. And there, thus, the rules for fasting and abstinence in the United States are, this is the rules they give. You know, people say, yeah, we follow Christ. Every person 14 years of age or old must abstain from meat and items made with meat on Ash Wednesday, Good Friday, and all the Fridays of Lent. Every person between the age of 18 and 59, beginning of the 60th year, must fast on Ash Wednesday and Good Friday. Again, nothing wrong with fasting. I'm just saying they're making a proclamation saying, you know, these are things that God has said are good to eat, but no, you're not going to eat them on these days. And he says, you know, and he goes on and makes that proclamation. He says, and items made with meat on all other Fridays of the year, every Friday. Nope, can't have no meat. Unless he or she substitutes some other form of penance or abstinence. Again, I mean, if you're part of this or whatever, I would say, hey, look, study God's word. Listen to what God says about these things and what, you know, men, when men make up doctrine. Right? Again, this is what Paul, not me, this is what he calls a doctrine of demons. You know, to say, hey, we're going to tell you to abstain from something that God created to be received with thanksgiving. Again, I'm not bringing this up to criticize people who practice this, because you do whatever you want, and if you're doing it to praise God, more about this. I'm just saying I want to show that what Paul predicted, right? I just want to show you that what Paul predicted has come true. That we have tangible proofs of fulfilled prophecy. So what about the other prophecies Paul makes? The return of Christ at the last trump, resurrection of the saints. Again, those things that happen, there's things that haven't happened. But the credibility to me is, you know what? Paul speaks for God. Because he passes the prophet's test. He passes the test of the prophet. He says something that would happen in latter times. Well, I can look and see, looks like it's happening. He passes the test. All right, let's look at another one. In the New Testament, this is John. The book of Revelation. Book of Revelation makes a ton of prophetic predictions. And all these predictions are credible and reliable. And I have people who come up to me and tell me they got it all figured out about what's going to happen in Revelation. I don't have it figured out. I don't know. I know it's going to happen. I know there's going to be fulfillment. But I do know that there actually has been some that have been fulfilled. And you know, you can go to what Christ specifically says about the churches that were in Asia. And the things he says, they happened back then. But I'm going to give you something else here in Revelation 6. Revelation 6, a fulfillment. Revelation 6, verse 1. So now I saw when the Lamb opened one of the seals, and I heard one of the four living creatures saying with a voice like thunder, "Come and see." And I looked, and behold, a white horse. He who sat on it had a bow, and a crown was given to him, and he went out conquering and to conquer. Right. So, and this seems... And this can seem to be a little cryptic to a lot of folks. Like, here's, you know, this is the, you know, four horsemen of the apocalypse. This is the first horseman. Later in chapter 19 in Revelation, we see Christ on a white horse. He's not with a bow, but he's with a sword coming out of his mouth. There's a difference in, you know, so this is something that's like Christ, but with different description. In chapter 19, 11, 16, we return to Christ, returns on a white horse. He has many crowns. This one on the horse right here is wearing just one crown and the conqueror. So the rider on the white horse, similar to Christ, but not Christ. And actually, we have to confirm this with what's written in Matthew 24. Because Christ defines sequence of event of the four horses. These are things that happen from the time after Christ all the way until now. I'm just going to talk about the first horse. Has this been fulfilled? Can we say that this is evidence that this thing has happened? All right, because we see here, we see the white horse, red horse, pale horse, black horse here. But in Matthew, I think I'm in Matthew 24, or maybe 25. My notes, I didn't write it in there good, so I'm reading from Matthew, believe me. All right, Matthew verse 4 says, "And Jesus answered and said to them, 'Take heed that no one deceives you, for many will come in my name, saying, I am the Christ, and will deceive many, and you will hear of wars and rumors of wars.'" So in Matthew 24. "Many will come by name and say, 'I'm Christ,' will see many, and you'll hear wars and rumors of war." Right? False Christ. And then he talks about wars, rumor of wars, deceiving many. He's talking about those who profess that either he is Christ or that they are Christ, and they are going to deceive many people. And then the other events, they line up with these four horsemen. This is something, you know, that you can look at and test. We have a booklet about it. We have a lot of people have taught about this for years. All right. So the rider of the white horse, false deceivers that will conquer. And do we have examples of this prophecy being fulfilled in history? We have examples of false, you know, people coming in Christ's name, conquering. We have examples of Islam that calls Christ a prophet, conquering. We can present a very good argument that this prophecy has occurred from that time up until now, is written. Solid facts that the prophecy has been and is being fulfilled. So again, to me, when he says, you know, this white horse, that gives credibility to John. Especially, you know, we didn't get into what he has, you know, it would take me forever to go through what he predicts about those churches in Asia and what has been fulfilled. But he makes solid predictions. And we can know that the rest of the things he says, what he talks about, the new, you know, the new heaven, the new earth, our place in that, the resurrection, we can know solidly, right, that John speaks for God. He passes the test. He passes the prophet's test. Passes the prophet's test. And so that's just, you know, that's something we should be definitely excited about, that we have the knowledge and truth, and we should love this truth. Love this truth. The world, they argue they don't know what truth is. Whatever. We have truth. We have it proof from God to us that what we believe is true, and we can continue to keep believing it, and we have it right now, and we thank God for that truth. So what is truth? Jesus Christ. Jesus is truth.